This is the motto of the show, Hour of the Truth. Rome never changes. They used to call us heretics and sent the Inquisition to kill us. Today they call us terrorists and send on their crusades. Times and methods may have changed, but the goal still stays the same. Extirpate the remnant of the true Word of God, Bible-believing people who uphold the truth in Jesus Christ's name.
Suffering at the hands of Rome, 'cause they believed in Christ alone. They died through Europe, especially Spain, for they saw all but Christ is vain. He suffered by his death for men, to save them from their awful sin. 600 years of martyred saints that history cannot erase. With iron heel and iron hand, the Roman popes rule the land. Those ignorant of history may be swept into apostasy. We won't be lulled by Rome's sweet lie, with 50 million reasons why. Salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. A sovereign God give faith to man. Salvation's in the Maker's hand. This gospel offends Rome today. They offer up another way, a counterfeit, a compromise. Beware the ancient papal lie, with such a cloud of witnesses who by grace died in their Lord. Recall their memory to say, by the same faith we live today.
Hello everybody, this is Jörg Lissmann once again from Hour of the Truth. I'm here on the evening on the 17th of April 2016, and it has been a while. I have to admit that I did a show on my own on Hour of the Truth, where I was starting to read the book, as you already know, and this is now part 7 that I do that, An Understandable History of the Bible by Samuel C. Gibb. It's quite a task to take that upon my shoulders next to all the other assignments that I wanted to do and that I did lately, and I have been very busy uploading, reading and producing videos in German for my German brethren. So because of that, I maybe neglected a little bit my English viewers and my English subscribers, but I can tell you I have a lot of things to do. And when I'm ready with the book Babylon Mystery Religion that I also read on my channel right now, I'm there at, I think, chapter 12 for the moment of 20 chapters, and I finished that, I will take on a new task and even read another book in English on my channel. But Hour of the Truth is reserved normally for shows with special guests, like in the past, you know, I have had Brett Norman, I have had Tom Fress, and I will surely have some other guests also, because someone who I followed already quite some time on the internet for some years has all of a sudden taken contact with me, and we are talking now via the telephone together, and when we are able to record that via Skype, I will also make a show with him. And well, I leave his name secret for the moment, it's not that important, but I will have other guests on my program. But today, as I told you, I have come here together I've come here on my own to continue the reading of An Understandable History of the Bible, where we took off last time. And when you want to check that, just go to the archives of the playlist Hour of the Truth, and you will notice that every time when I read the book, it is marked with what part I've been reading, and the last part has been part 6. I still continue in the chapter called The Witnesses on the part of that chapter that is called False Witness from Rome. So without any further ado, here we go, An Understandable History of the Bible by Samuel C. Gibb. Another manuscript belonging to this family is called Vaticanus. It is often referred to by the letter B. As its name implies, it is in the Vatican Library at Rome. Remember your enemy, you know. It's always Rome. No one knows when it was placed in the Vatican Library, but its existence was first made known in 1841. This manuscript is also in the form of a book and written on vellum. It contains 759 pages, which are 10 by 10.5 inches, with three columns of 41 lines per page. This codex omits many portions of scripture vital to Christian doctrine. Why is that? Well, because the Roman Catholic Church is not Christian. It is the pagan empire baptized, Christianized, but it is still pagan. Vaticanus omits Genesis 1 verse 1 through Genesis 46 28, Psalms 106 through 138, Matthew 16 2 and 3, Romans 16 24, the Pauline pastoral epistles, Revelation, and everything in Hebrews after chapter 9 verse 14. Quite a Bible, right? It seems suspicious indeed that a manuscript possessed by the Roman Catholic Church omits the portion of the book of Hebrews, which exposes the Mass as totally useless. Therefore, we read Hebrews chapter 10, verse 10 to 12. Quote, "By the which will we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest standeth daily ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God." Unquote. The Mass, in conjunction with the false doctrine of purgatory, go hand in hand to form a perpetual money-making machine for Rome. Without one or the other, the Roman Catholic Church would go broke. It also omits portions of scripture telling of the creation in Genesis, the prophetic details of the crucifixion in Psalms 22, and, of course, the portion which prophesies the destruction of Babylon, which is Rome, the great whore of Revelation chapter 17. And I would very much like to go for a deeper understanding now to go to read to you Psalm 22, which is omitted in the Vaticanus manuscript found in Rome. Psalm 22. Quote, "My God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring? O my God, I cry in the daytime, but thou hearest not, and in the night season, and am not silent. But thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in thee, they trusted, and thou didst deliver them. They cried unto thee, and were delivered. They trusted in thee, and were not confounded. But I am a worm, and no man, a reproach of men, and despised of the people. All they that see me laugh to me scorn. They shoot out the lip, they take the heat, saying, He trusted on the Lord that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him, seeing he delighted in him. But thou art that took me out of the womb. Thou didst make me hope when I was upon my mother's breasts. I was cast upon thee from the womb. Thou art my God from my mother's belly. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, for there is none to help. Many bulls have compassed me. Strong bulls of Bashan have beset me around. They gaped upon me with their mouths as a ravening and roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax, it is melted in the midst of my bowels. My strength is dried up as a potsherd, like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to my jaws, and thou hast brought me into the dust of death. For dogs have compassed me, the assembly of the wicked have enclosed me, they pierced my hands and my feet. I may tell all my bones, they look and stare upon me. They part my garments among them, and cast lots upon my vesture. But be not thou far from me, O Lord, O my strength, haste thee to help me. Deliver my soul from the sword, my darling from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth, for thou hast heard me from the horns of the unicorns. I will declare thy name unto my brethren, in the midst of the congregation will I praise thee. Ye that fear the Lord, praise him, and ye the seed of Jacob, glorify him, and fear him, and all ye the seed of Israel. For he hath not despised nor abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, neither has he hid his face from him, but when he cried unto him, he heard. My praise shall be of thee in the great congregation. I will pay my vows before thee after the fear. I will pay my vows before them that fear me, that fear him. I'm sorry, butchered that. Verse 25 again. My praise shall be of thee in the great congregation. I will pay my vows before them that fear him. The meek shall eat and be satisfied. They shall praise the Lord that seek him. Your heart shall live forever. All the ends of the world shall remember and turn unto the Lord, and all the kindreds of the nations shall worship before thee. For the kingdom is the Lord's, and he is the governor among the nations. All they that be fed upon the earth shall eat and worship. All they that go down to the dust shall bow before him, and none can keep alive his own soul. A seed shall serve him. It shall be accounted to the Lord for a generation. They shall come and shall declare his righteousness unto a people that shall be born, that he hath done this. End quote. And I will also read the complete chapter 17 of Revelation to you, because this cannot be repeated often enough. At least this is what I think about that. So here we go. And there came one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials, and talked with me, saying unto me, Come hither, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast, full of names and blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. And the angel said unto me, Wherefore didst thou marvel? I will tell thee the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carrieth her, which hath the seven heads and ten horns. The beast that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they behold the beast that was, and is not, and yet is. And here is the mind which hath wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sitteth. And there are seven kings. Five are fallen, and one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth, and is of the seventh, and goeth into perdition. And the ten horns which thou sawest are ten kings, which have received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. These have one mind, and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings. And they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful. And he saith unto me, The waters which thou sawest, where the whore sitteth, are peoples, and multitudes, and nations, and tongues. And the 10 horns which thou sawest upon the beast, these shall hate the whore, and shall make her desolate and naked, and shall eat her flesh, and burn her with fire. For God hath put in their hearts to fulfill his will, and to agree, and give their kingdom unto the beast, until the words of God shall be fulfilled. And the woman which thou sawest is that great city, which reigneth over the kings of the earth. Unquote. Of course, we all know this talks about Rome, that has its foundations in Babylon. Continuing in the text, Vaticanus, though intact physically, is found to be of very poor literary quality. Dr. Martin declares, quote, B exhibits numerous places where the scribe has written the same word or phrase twice in succession, unquote. Dr. J. Smythe states, quote, From one end to the other, the whole manuscript has been travelled over by the pen of some scribe of about the 10th century, unquote. If Vaticanus was considered a trustworthy text originally, the mass of corrections and scribal changes obviously render its testimony highly suspicious and questionable. The corrupt and unreliable nature of these two manuscripts is best summed up by one who has thoroughly examined them, John W. Burgeon. Quote, The impurity of the text exhibited by the codices is not a question of opinion, but fact. In the Gospel alone, Codex B, meaning Vaticanus, leaves out words or whole clauses no less than 1,491 times. It bears traces of careless transcriptions on every page. Codex Sinaiticus abounds with errors of the eye and pen to an extent not indeed unparalleled, but happily rather unusual in documents of first-rate importance. On many occasions, 10, 20, 30, 40 words are dropped through very carelessness. Letters and words, even whole sentences, are frequently written twice over, or begun and immediately cancelled. While that gross blunder whereby a clause is omitted because it happens to end in the same words as the clause preceding, occurs no less than 115 times in the New Testament. If we are to be thorough and If we are to be thorough and discriminatory in our evaluation of the New Testament text, then we must not, we cannot overlook these facts. It's not opinion, people, it's facts. How did these manuscripts come into being? How did it happen that they should be beautiful to the eye, yet within contain such vile and devastating corruptions? It seems that these manuscripts, along with the papyrus manuscripts included in this category, all resulted from a revision of the true or universal text. That is still the Textus Receptus, as you understand it. This revision was enacted in Egypt. Remember our study of Egypt in previous chapters of the book. By Egyptian scribes. Prior to documenting this statement, it will be needful to identify several of the Uncial and papyrus manuscripts which will be referred to in the documentation. These are Uncial manuscripts A, B, C, D, and Aleph. Also included are the Chester Beatty papyri, designated as P45, 46, 47, and the Bodmer papyri, designated as P66 and P75. Now we come to speak about the local mess. M-E-S-S, yeah? Not M-A-S-S. The local mess. What a mess they made. It seems that this type of text was a local text of Alexandria, Egypt, of which Eusebius made 50 copies to fulfill a request by Emperor Constantine. Unfortunately, Eusebius turned to the education center in Egypt and got a scholarly revision instead of turning to Antioch for the pure text which was universally accepted by the true Christians. Why would Eusebius choose Alexandria over Antioch, you ask? Well, primarily because he was a great admirer of Origen, an Egyptian scholar. Origen, though once exalted by modern-day Christianity as a trustworthy authority, has since been found to have been a heretic who interpreted the Bible in the light of Greek philosophy. So, you remember our study of Athens, of course. He interpreted the Bible in the light of Greek philosophy. That makes him a perfect, an undeniable perfect Roman Catholic, because Roman Catholicism and the teaching thereof all is based on Greek philosophy, on Gnosticism. But the author continues, he propagated the heresy that Jesus Christ was a created God. This is false doctrine clung to by Jehovah's Witnesses of our day, who strangely enough get their teaching from the corrupt Alexandrian text rendition of John 1:1-5 and John 3:13, a corruption which Origen is responsible for when he revised the universal text to read in agreement with his personal heresy. So, what are the? So I'm reading now from John, the first chapter, the first 5 verses from the Jehovah's Witnesses Bible. And after that I read the King James, and you will see the deception therein for yourself. So the Jehovah's Witnesses Bible reads as follows, quote, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was a God. This one was in the beginning with God. All things came into existence through him, and apart from him not even one thing came into existence. What has come into existence by means of him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light is shining in the darkness, but the darkness has not overpowered it." End quote. And the King James Bible reads, quote, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not." Unquote. I am quite sure that you realized what they did to the Word of God here. Saying that, and the Word was a God, so there are more than one God. There's more than one God according to Jehovah's Witnesses Bible? I guess so. I continue in John 3:13 from the Jehovah's Witnesses Bible. Quote, "Moreover, no man has ascended into heaven, but the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man." Unquote. The King James Bible reads, quote, "And no man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man, which is in heaven." Unquote. This is a corruption which Origen is responsible for when he revised the universal text to read in agreement with his personal heresy, the author continues. Origen himself said, quote, "The scriptures are of little use to those who understand them, as they are written," unquote. Which explains Bishop March's statement, quote, "Whenever therefore grammatical interpretation produced a sense which in Origen's opinion was irrational or impossible, in other words, was irrational or impossible according to the philosophy which Origen had learned at Alexandria, he then departs from the literal," unquote. Dr. Adam Clarke claims also that Origen was the first person to teach purgatory. And that guy is called Origen, yeah? In the way almost that we use the word today. Okay, we continue with the sub-paragraph titled Total Corruption. Where did this local text, from which all new Bible translations since 1881 are rendered, originate? Let us see what evidence scholars have unearthed in a search to discover its source. Kurt Aland, quote, proposes that the text of P75 and B represent a revision of local text of Egypt, which was enforced as the dominant text in that particular ecclesiastical province, unquote. Professor Hodges assures us that, quote, already scholars are willing to concede a common ancestry for P75 and B. We can postulate here that this common ancestor and P66 meet even further back in the stream of transmission. It is quite possible, then, that all three manuscripts go back ultimately to a single parent manuscript in which the emendation was originally made. Unquote. Dean Burgeon remarks, quote, as for the origin of these two curiosities, it can perforce only be divined from their contents that they exhibit fabricated texts is demonstrable. No amount of honest copying, preserved in for any number of countries, could be possibly have resulted in two such documents, separated from one another in actual date by 50, perhaps 100 years. They must need have branched all from a common corrupt ancestor and straightway become exposed to fresh depraving influence. Dr. Edward Hills concludes, quote, the best way to explain this situation is to suppose that it represents an intentional neglect, of the traditional text on the part of those ancient Alexandrian scribes who kept revising the text of Papyrus 75 until finally they created the B text. Unquote. He also states Allen's opinion, quote, Allen thinks it's possible that the Chester Beatty papyri also came from this same place. Unquote. The tedious lawyer and former Supreme Court Justice Philip Morrow has aptly determined, quote, it should be observed before we proceed with this question that the agreeing testimony, where they do agree, of the Vatican and Sinaitic manuscripts cannot be properly regarded as having the force of two independent witnesses, for there are sufficient evidences, both internal and external, to warrant the conclusion that these two codices are very closely related, that they are, in fact, copies of the same original, itself a very corrupt transcript of the New Testament. And he also states, quote, it is admitted on all hands that the text used by the basis of the authorized versions correctly represents a text known to have been widely, if not anywhere, in use as early as the 2nd century, for the Peshitta and the Old Latin versions corroborated by patristic quotations afford ample proof of that. On the other hand, it is now known that the two codices were we are discussing represent anything but copies of a bad original, made worse even in the copying. Unquote. It also seems generally agreed that this local text was used for a basis of the 50 Bibles which Eusebius supplied to Constantine. The noted Greek scholar A.T. Robertson states, quote, Constantine himself ordered 50 Greek Bibles from Eusebius, Bishop of Caesarea, for the churches of Constantinople. It is quite possible that Aleph and B are two of these 50, though the actual copying was probably done in Egypt or by Egyptian scribes. Unquote. And Gregory adds, quote, this manuscript, the Vaticanus, is supposed, as we have seen, to have come from the same place as the Sinaitic manuscript. I have said that these two show connections with each other, and that they would suit very well as a pair of the 50 manuscripts written at Caesarea for Constantine the Great. Unquote. To which Burgeon and Miller testify, quote, Constantine applied to Eusebius for 50 handsome copies, amongst which it is not impossible that the manuscripts B and Aleph were not to be actually found. Unquote. Dr. David Fuller finalizes, quote, Age alone cannot prove that the manuscript is correct. B and Aleph probably owe their preservation to the fact that they were written on vellum, whereas most other documents of that period were written on papyrus. Many students, including Tischendorf and Hort, have thought them to be two of the 50 copies which Eusebius had prepared under the order of Constantine for use in the churches of Constantinople. They are no doubt beautiful manuscripts, but their texts show scribal carelessness. B exhibits numerous places where the scribe has written the same word or phrases twice in succession. Aleph shows the marks of 10 different correctors down through the centuries. Bergen's excoriation of Westcott and Hort's method cannot be considered too strong in the light of the facts concerning the characters of these two manuscripts. Unquote. Now, who would be responsible for the corruption of the universally accepted text of the New Testament? Wilkinson reports, quote, "Beginning shortly after the death of the Apostle John, four names stand out in prominence whose teaching contributed both to the victorious heresy and to the final issuing of manuscripts of a corrupt New Testament. These names are, first, Justin Martyr, 2. Tatian, 3. Clement of Alexandria, and 4. Origen." Unquote. The local Alexandrian text fell into disuse about 500 AD, while the original universal text was spreading through Christianity throughout Europe. Hoskier reports in this statement, quote, "Those who accept the Westcott and Hort text are basing their accusations on untruth as to the Gospelist upon Egyptian revision current 200 to 450 AD and abandoned between 500 to 1881 AD, merely revised in our day and stamped as genuine." Unquote. Yeah, you know, the Roman Catholic Church also stamps the donation of Constantine genuine, or at least they act as it was, even though that they admit in their papers, in their encyclopedia and in other papers from the Roman Catholic Church, that the donation of Constantine is a fraud. And here with the books and the scribes, they do just the same thing, and they stamp them as genuine. So we see that once a pure copy of the universal text had been carried down into Egypt, it was recopied. During the process of this recopying, it was revised by men who did not reverse it as truly the word of God. This text was examined by the critical eye of Greek philosophy and Egyptian morals. And what have these to do with Christianity? Huh? Greek philosophy and Egyptian morals have nothing to do with the Bible. And when they interpret the Bible or rewrite the Bible, you see what you get. This is the same what you get in America, where the Supreme Court consists of 6 Catholics and 3 Jews. They are to interpret the Constitution, and look what they do with it. That so-called Protestant paper that you have there is interpreted by Roman Catholics and Jews. And this is just the same over here with the Bible. The author continues, "These men saw nothing wrong with putting the book in subjection to their opinion, instead of their opinion being in subjection to the book, as it should be. This process produced a text which was local to the educational center of Alexandria in Egypt. This text went no farther than southern Italy, where the Roman Church found its unstable character perfect for overthrowing the true word of God, which was being used universally by the true Christians." The author concludes this chapter of the book with, quote, "At this point, I believe it will be helpful to study the ruthless Roman Catholic Church to more clearly understand her part in all new translations of the Bible since 1881. I do absolutely agree. A study of the Roman Catholic Church is absolutely important for understanding the truth, Because when you are bombarded all your life with lies and you don't know the truth, how can you see the lies through the lies? You maybe discover one here and one there, but then you go on in the same way. Therefore, it is absolutely imperative to know the truth, which is the true Word of God, which is in the King James Bible, to expose lie after lie after lie. It is not because we know the truth that we don't have to understand the lie also, because only when we understand the lie or expose the lie, we understand the lie, we can expose the lie and can tell other people about it, can teach other people about it, which is a little bit the purpose of this book reading of an understandable history of the Bible, that you understand why and where they changed the Bible, the true Word of God, that it is fulfilling their imperatives, that it is fulfilling their meanings instead of the meaning of the Word of God. You have to know the true Word to expose the lie. Therefore, I still advocate reading the King James Bible of 1611. But we continue in chapter 7, which is called The Enemy. And it starts with a wonderful quote from Pope Boniface VIII from his bull Unum Sanctam from 1303. This is a quote that I have often read already in Hour of the Truth, so you're probably familiar with it. Quote, "It is necessary to salvation that every man should submit to the Pope." Unquote. I most of the times read this in a few little other words, but the essence is the same. It is necessary for the salvation of every human creature to be a subject to the Roman Pontiff or to Pontifex Maximus. There are few different quotations out there. Which is the absolute origin doesn't matter, because they all say the same, just using here and there a little other word. But because this is the word of the Pope, it is not that bad when you change a few words in it. It's not the Bible. But from the Bible comes our next quote, from the book of Ephesians, chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. Quote, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." Unquote. Here lie two totally contradictory statements. They cannot both be corrected. The one which you will believe, which you will depend on, which authority you accept. So whether you believe the Pope, that it is absolutely necessary for salvation, that every man should be subject to the Pope, or you believe what the Bible says, that you are saved through faith, not by yourself, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. What do you believe? Do you believe Christ, or you believe Antichrist? That's the big question. Now, the Roman Catholic Church has long been antagonistic to the doctrine of salvation by faith. If salvation is by grace, who needs a mass? If salvation is by grace, who needs to fear purgatory? If Jesus Christ is our mediator, who needs the Pope? If the Pope cannot intimidate people into obeying him, how can he force a nation to obey him? The true Bible is the arch enemy of Roman Catholic Church. Rome can only rule over ignorant, fear-filled people. The true Bible turns unlearned and ignorant men into gospel preachers and casts out all fear. Rome must find a way to supplant the true gospel with another gospel. The only way to do this is to eliminate our faith in the Word of God. A little comment from me. How can you eliminate our faith in the Word of God? Let's talk about a young Christian, 21 years, stepping into a library or a bookshop, wanting to buy a Bible. He asks the clerk where the Bible stand. He shows him a part in the shop where there is a cupboard, and on that cupboard are 34 different Bible versions. NASV, RSV, NIV, ESV, New Living Translation, I don't know. Whatever name you want to give to that. And this person who is seriously seeking Christ stands now before that cupboard and asks himself, if there are so many words that God has written, which is the true one? Well, if I don't know which the true word is, then I'm not gonna read it at all. And this is the result of putting out so many different Bibles and so-called words of God, where the word of God was only once written and preserved today in the 1611 King James Bible. That's why I'm reading this book here. This confusion will, not everyone, but will probably have an influence on a few people seriously looking for the word and the truth of God. When they are confronted with more than 30 or I don't know how many different Bibles on a shelf, and they don't understand which Bible to get. And even if they get two or three and they read them all and they will see all the differences in there, they are more confused after reading them than they were before. And their faith diminishes. And they turn to the teachings of men. And they go back to church. And with that, they are back in Rome. They are back in Babylon. But okay, the author continues. Rome received the corrupted local text of Alexandria, Egypt, and further revised it to suit her own needs. Some scholars call this revision the Western text. This, of course, makes it part of the already corrupted text and therefore still contains the local text readings. This text suited the Roman Catholic Church well, since it attacked the doctrines of the Bible. Rome is wise. To attack salvation by grace directly would expose her plot to all. So instead, she used subtlety. The Roman Catholic Church strips Jesus Christ of his deity, separates the divine title Lord and Christ from the human name Jesus, having the thief on the cross address him as Jesus instead of Lord, as we can read in Luke 23:42. It also removes the testimony to his deity in Acts 8:37, and it eliminates the Trinity in 1 John 5, verse 7. Now you may ask, would not a weakening of the place of Jesus Christ weaken the Roman Catholic Church's reason for even existing? The answer is no. The Roman Catholic Church does not even claim to represent the gospel of Jesus Christ. Romanist Carl Adam admits this, quote, "We Catholics acknowledge readily, without any shame, nay with pride, that Catholicism cannot be identified simply and wholly with primitive Christianity, nor even with the gospel of Christ." Unquote. The vacancy left by the removal of Christ would be easily filled by Mary and other saints, along with the chain of ritualism to so rigid that no practitioner would have time to really think about the true gospel. Now we come to the next part of this chapter called Invasion. The true gospel was fast spreading all over Europe due to the old Latin translation of the universal text into the Vulgar, or common language. This Bible became known as the Vulgate, since it was used so commonly all over Europe. Rome enlisted the help of a loyal subject by the name of Jerome. He quickly translated the corrupt local text into Latin. This version included the apocryphal books, 14 books which no Bible-believing Christian accepts as authentic. To ensure its succession over the old Latin, the Roman Catholic Church gave it the name Vulgate, meaning common. There was one problem which the Roman Catholic Church did not anticipate. The same problem which the businessmen publishing new versions cannot seem to avoid. The common people recognize the true word of God because the Holy Spirit bears witness to it. They refuse to accept other versions. True, many versions have been sold in the past and are being sold now. Yet, this is primarily due to the media blitz, by which every new Bible has been introduced since 1881. This is the same tactic used by Satan in Genesis chapter 3. Notice the first recorded words. Do you believe that Satan just walked up to Eve and asked, "Yea, hath God said?" No. In Genesis 3 verse 1, we are picking up in the middle of a conversation, possibly one of many. Satan paved the way for his attack on God's word by a little softening up publicity. Christians today do not realize that they need a better translation until they are told so by the Bible salesman a few times. Suddenly they realize their need for a translation which is closer to the originals. Most of these Christians have never even read the one they have. The next thing they know, they have eaten the fruit, and God's blessing is gone. To get God's blessing back, obviously, they need the next thoroughly reliable translation. And this is not an overstatement. An example of the Bible business is revealed by Dr. Edward Hills. He speaks in reference to the committee of the American Standard Version promising not to publish their translation at the same time as the English Revised Version, the ERV. He points out, quote, "They promised not to publish their own revised edition of the Bible until 14 years after the publication of the English Revised Version, RV, and in exchange for this concession were given the privilege of publishing in an appendix to this version a list of the readings which they favored, but which the British revisers declined to adopt." Unquote. It was obvious to these, quote, "contenders for the faith," unquote, that two new Bibles hitting the market at the same time, just would not be conducive to good profits. These men are obviously led by the Spirit, but I'm not entirely sure it is holy. It is a sad thing when men make merchandise of the Word of God. What does God teach us in that regard? Buy the truth and sell it not. The name Vulgate on the fly leaf of Jerome's unreliable translation did little to help sales. The Old Latin Bible, or Italic as it is sometimes called, was held fast by all true Christians who upheld the authority of the Bible over the authority of education. The Bible over the authority of education. Learning by learning. Medici learning. Jesuitical teachings. Dr. Wilkinson informs us in reference to the Old Latin, quote, "Not only were such translations in existence long before the Vulgate was adopted by the papacy and well established, but the people for centuries refused to supplant their old Latin Bibles by the Vulgate." He records Jacobus' words, quote, "The old Latin version were used longest by the Western Christians who would not bow to the authority of Rome, e.g. the Donatists, the Irish in Ireland, Britain and the continent, the Albigenses, etc." Unquote. Dr. Wilkinson also records the words from the Forum of June 1887. Quote, "The old Italic version, into rude Low Latin of the second century, held its own as long as Latin continued to be the language of the people. The critical version of Jerome never displaced it, and only replaced it when the Latin ceased to be a living language and became the language of the learned." Well, if a language is dead, it's the language of the dead, right? And Satan is the god of death, so, of course, he uses Latin. The Gothic version of Ulfilas, in the same way, held its own until the tongues in which it was written ceased to exist. Unquote. So we see that the Vulgate of Jerome was unused and unwanted by the true Christians for over 900 years. This caused the Roman Catholic Church much grief. There was only one remedy to the situation: eliminate the other, old, archaic Bible. If it was necessary to violently eliminate the people who used this faithful translation, then they did it. You were not only persecuted for having a Bible, you were also persecuted for reading the Bible, possessing a Bible, and not only then the Bible was burned, but you were burned at the stake too. It's called Inquisition, started in 1205 by the papacy. Okay, next part of the chapter is called The Plot. The Roman Catholic Church has long been known for its persecution of true New Testament Christians. Beginning in about 600 AD, persecution hounded these Christ-honoring, Bible-loving people. Pope Gregory I went so far as to systematically destroy and alter historical records pertaining to these Christians. Concerning one group, the Waldenses or Waldensians, Dr. Gilly reports, quote, "It is a singular thing that the destruction of Rapine, which has been so fatal to Waldensian documents, would have pursued them even to the place of security to which all that remained were consigned by Morland in 1658, the library of the University of Cambridge. The most ancient of these relics were ticketed in 7 packets, distinguished by letters of the alphabet from A to G. The whole of these were missing when I made inquiry of them in 1823. Unquote. Gilly also enlightens us with this report of the actions of Rome. Quote, "The agents of the papacy have done their utmost to calumniate their character, to destroy the records of their noble past, and to leave no trace of the cruel persecution they underwent. They went even further. They made use of words written against ancient heresies to strike out the name of heretics and fill the blank space by inserting the name of the Waldenses. Just as if in a book written to record the lawless deeds of some bandit like Jesse James, his name should be stricken out and the name of Abraham Lincoln substituted. The Jesuit Gretzerin, a book written against the heretics of the 12th and 13th century, put the name Waldenses at the point where he struck out the name of these heretics." Unquote. We find that Rome's wicked persecution of the Waldenses culminated in a devastating massacre of their number in 1655. They were hounded as heretics until the mid-1800s, when their persistence paid off and the vile actions against them ceased. Now we come to the counterattack. A major blow of the authority of Rome came in 1517, when a young Catholic priest by the name of Martin Luther nailed his historic 95 Theses on the church door in Wittenberg. I have to stop here a moment. I spent more than a week and a half, the last days, reading and examining and recording the reading of a paper that is called Luther 2017, 500 years after the Reformation, where do we stand now? That's a German paper, and I analyzed that paper and read that paper in a little more than 7 hours. It's 30 pages of text. So 7 hours for 30 pages of text. So I went quite deep into that. And now I have an opportunity, because I come to read the counterattack, and we mentioned the name of Martin Luther and the 95 theses that he nailed on the church door in Wittenberg in 1517. I have a chance here on Hour of the Truth to speak about that event. But of course you all know of that event. But are you also aware that we are almost only 18 months or so away from the 500th anniversary of Protestantism, of the Reformation? A part in our history that changed the world forever at that time? People threw away their kings, rebelled against their kings, who were all led by the papacy, and installed governments of themselves, democratic, republican, or whatever, to govern themselves, because they understood they already had Jesus Christ. For the first time in history, the people were able to read the Bible in their own language after Luther translated the New Testament in 1522, after 1517, starting the Reformation. So this book reading I did in Germany, I hope it will be very well received on my YouTube channel, and every German listener who listens to this Hour of the Truth, I would ask also to have a look at these ones. I made an own playlist of the seven readings called Luther 2017, and there you can find those readings. And this is a very, very important part of history, because we all would not be here today if the Reformation, the first strike of the deadly wound of the beast of Revelation 13, would not have happened. Now, the first strike was the Reformation in 1517, or the beginning of Protestantism, and the second strike was in 1798 by General Berthier, but that was done by Napoleon, who was a 33rd degree Freemason, so he was under the control of the Black Papacy, but it was even the Black Papacy themselves that gave that strike. If you want to know more about that, go to my readings of Rulers of Evil, and I will explain to you, by reading between the lines even of what Tupper Saucy wrote, that Lorenzo Ricci very, very cunningly worked for that, the abolishment of the Jesuits in 1773 and the capture of the Pope in 1798 were all things planned long ahead, and just planned to, yeah, in a way, fight Protestantism by imputing the idea into the Protestants, look, the Jesuits are forbidden, they don't exist anymore, and now look, even the Pope is being taken captive, he does have no power anymore, so you have nothing to fear anymore. So, then we're gonna teach you from now on that the Antichrist is a single person, coming maybe only 7 years before Jesus Christ's return, because we teach to you the unfulfilled Daniel's 70-week prophecy, which is not fulfilled for the Roman Catholic mind, because they are gonna do that in the future. But this is now going too far. I just wanted to mention that I did this Luther 2017 reading in German, and when you understand German, I invite you very much to come to my channel and follow those readings, and because there I go very, very deep into everything that was relied to the Protestant Reformation, to Protestantism, and to the Reformation altogether. So, but we're gonna continue now here in Counterattack right now. So, continuing reading the Counterattack. A major blow to the authority of Rome came in 1517 when a young Catholic priest by the name of Martin Luther nailed his 95 historic theses on the church door in Wittenberg. The nail drove deep into the hearts of truly born-again Christians who had for centuries been laboring under the tyranny of Roman Catholic Church. The people flocked to their new, brave leader. From this, Lutheranism was established. But even more important, the fires of the Reformation were kindled. The tide of the Reformation soon came sweeping across all of Europe until it washed the very shores of England. The already weakened authority of Rome was devastated by the onslaught of truth. Two-thirds of Europe was swallowed up in what can probably be referred to as the greatest spiritual awakening of all time. I absolutely agree with that. That was the hand of God, as predicted by Jesus Christ in Matthew 24, that the time of the tribulation for the elect's sake will be shortened. The Reformation was vital to the then future translation of the King James Bible. England, too, had been shackled to the hierarchy of Rome. It was the removal of these superstitious bonds that created the spirit in England of the supremacy of the Scripture, which was prevalent at the time of the translation of the King James Bible. This would not have been the case had Luther not sparked the Reformation. The most vital and immovable weapon in Luther's arsenal came in the form of his German translation of the New Testament of 1522. This put the pure words of the universal text back into the hands of the Bible-starved Christians. The Reformation ran wild across the continent, fueled by this faithful translation. Rome, at this point, was totally helpless to stop it. The papacy needed something with which to fight this dreaded scourge of truth. It turned in desperation to two different sources. In 1545, the Roman Catholic Church formed the Council of Trent. The Council of Trent systematically denied the teachings of the Reformation. The Council decreed that tradition was of equal authority with the Bible. It decreed also that justification was not by faith alone in the shed of blood of Jesus Christ. In fact, it stated that anyone believing in this vital Bible doctrine was cursed, was a heretic, was anathema. The council's exact words are, quote, "If anyone saith that justifying faith is nothing else but confidence in the divine mercy which remits sins for Christ's sake, or that this confidence alone is that whereby we are justified, let him be anathema," unquote. And at the end of the Council of Trent, the Council of Trent published 125 anathemas to heretics, Protestants, who they call today separated brethren. I am a true Bible-believing Christian and not a separated Christian, a separated brother or brethren from the whore of Babylon. How about you? We now see that the Roman Catholic Church is guilty of officially cursing Jesus Christ. Would God use this church to preserve his words? Think about it, Roman Catholics. Just think a little moment for yourselves. The Council of Trent was viewed by the Protestants as somewhat of a paper tiger. It certainly did not hold any authority over them. The barn door appeared securely locked, but the horse was triumphantly roaming all over the countryside. Yet, there was to be an enemy much more feared than the boisterous Council of Trent, the Jesuits. And the next part of this book, called The Diabolical Jesuits, and also probably going a little bit into more explanation of the Council of Trent, we will do in another Hour of the Truth. As a true viewer of Hour of the Truth, you see that with 1 hour I'm half an hour short of other broadcasts, but because I only did a book reading, which takes much of your concentration and my concentration, I will stop here at 1 hour. But I'm really looking forward to read the next part of the book, An Understandable History of the Bible by Samuel C. Gibb, titled The Diabolical Jesuits. And I will probably have much more notes of my own with this next reading. But until then, keep an eye on my channel and my broadcasts, and there will be a lot of German broadcasts in the next weeks, I can assure you. And thank you very much for watching, listening, commenting in the comment box. And thank you very much for your attention. Until the next time, God bless you all. Keep you safe in his ways. Jogler 66 from Hour of the Truth, signing off. God bless you and bye-bye.